Hello, I'm Moira Alderson with the BBC News. President Biden and the Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky are holding a joint press conference at the White House as the Ukrainian leader makes his first overseas trip since the Russian invasion began. Mr. Biden said the US would continue to strengthen Ukraine's ability to defend itself. He said on the 300th day since the Russian invasion began, Ukraine continued to inspire the American people.
300 days since Putin launched an unprovoked, unjustified, all-out assault on the free people of Ukraine. 300 days of Ukrainian people showing Russia and the world their steel backbone, their love of country, and their unbreakable determination, and I emphasize unbreakable determination, to choose their own path.
Mr. Biden said the latest support would include the Patriot missile defense system. He pledged new and more security assistance worth $1.85 billion. Earlier, Mr. Zelensky expressed his gratitude for Washington's backing. Vladimir Putin has told his top defense officials that the Russian army can have whatever it needs to win the war in Ukraine. During a televised speech in Moscow, the Russian president said all military equipment should be the most up-to-date. He said hypersonic missiles would be deployed on board a Russian warship from January. He also talked of improving the combat readiness of the country's strategic nuclear forces. At least 10 people have died of electrocution in the northern Nigerian state of Kaduna following the restoration of power after a blackout. The local authorities said a number of other people were injured. Isaac Khalid reports from Abuja.
Residents of the city of Zaria told BBC they experienced widespread electric sparks, apparently caused by high voltage overnight. People were then electrocuted as they attempted to switch off appliances and power sources in their homes. Some buildings had also been destroyed by fire arising from the sparks. A man whose wife died and several other members of his family injured described the incident as tragic. The authorities say an investigation was underway.
Israel's Prime Minister-designate Benjamin Netanyahu has announced he's successfully formed a new government, minutes before a deadline. From Jerusalem, here's Yulan Nell.
After Benjamin Netanyahu's bloc won that convincing election win on the 1st of November, taking 64 out of 120 seats and ending a cycle that saw Israel keep returning to the polls, really people thought that Mr. Netanyahu would announce his new government quite quickly. After all, there's quite close ideological alignment between his own Likud party and his ultra-nationalist and ultra-Orthodox Jewish allies. But instead, we've seen that coalition talks have actually been quite strung out.
Yolande Nell reporting. World News from the BBC. The president of Peru, Dina Boluarte, has appointed a new cabinet after 2 weeks of deadly protests triggered by the impeachment and arrest of her predecessor, Pedro Castillo. At a ceremony in the capital, Lima, she named an experienced lawyer and politician, Alberto Otarola, as her prime minister. She also announced new defense and interior ministers. A court in Argentina has sentenced a former police officer to 15 years in jail for the forced disappearance of a student in the 1970s. Mario Sandoval was found guilty of abducting, torturing and killing Hernán Abriata. 30,000 people are estimated to have been killed in Argentina in the 1970s and 80s under the then military government. The World Trade Organization has found that the United States has violated international trade rules by insisting that products from Hong Kong be labeled as made in China. Hong Kong is a separate member of the WTO. Jonathan Josephs reports.
In June 2020, China imposed its national security law on Hong Kong, which severely curtailed residents' freedom. In response, the then US President Donald Trump decided that goods made in Hong Kong would have to be labelled as coming from China if they were imported to the world's biggest economy. The World Trade Organization says that was against the rules. But the Biden administration says it won't be changing its approach to an issue it deems a matter of national security. Hong Kong has welcomed the ruling, but there is little realistic hope anything will change given the broader US-China trade war.
Doctors treating the former Brazilian football star Pelé say he will have to remain in hospital during the Christmas period because his cancer has advanced. Pelé, who's 82, was diagnosed with colon cancer 3 years ago. He was admitted to hospital a month ago. His health has since deteriorated. He now requires care for renal and cardiac dysfunction. BBC News.